Tennessee won the toss, deferred. Alabama will get the ball. James Wilhoit will kick off. And Alabama's Crimson Tide leads the 117 NCAA Division I teams in kickoff returns. This one will go right by Brandon Brooks, and we go down to Tracy Wolfson.
Thanks, Vern. This week, Tennessee head coach Phil Fulmer made sure to remind his team, especially the younger players, just how big this rivalry is. He didn't only talk about tradition, he showed them a tape of past games, of hard hits, of big plays, of former coaches and former players who have been involved in this game. He said it was important for them to get a little flavor of what this rivalry was all about. He told his team in the past, and he's told them again this year, you do not become a man until you've beaten Alabama. Guys, back to you.
Thanks, Tracy. Spencer Pennington, his third start this season as the quarterback. He hands it off to Kenneth Darby. It is out to the 25-yard line. Spencer Pennington started the season as the number three quarterback behind Brody Croyle and Mark Gillen. Brody Croyle, broken leg, an injured knee in the third game. Gillen came on. He's having back problems, and so Spencer Pennington led this team to a victory at Kentucky 2 weeks ago and a victory at home last week.
I was impressed with the way Pennington looked in pregame. He's very confident, very excited, and threw the ball very well in the warm-ups.
Fumble picked up. Here goes Tennessee. Paris Harrelson.
I think Turk McBride is the guy who got the penetration and knocked that ball out.
McBride is starting for the injured Jesse Mahalona. Harrelson is fresh from a 10-tackle effort in the win at Ole Miss last Saturday night. And Spencer Pennington is in a state of disbelief. Wilhoit for the extra point. 18-yard return. McBride forces the fumble. Harrelson picks it in and rumbles in.
Here's McBride right here. Just the quick penetration is going to get into the backfield and cause the fumble on the exchange between the quarterback and Darby. Just a great quick play by Turk McBride, as you mentioned, making his first start today. He was a defensive end, he's moved to tackle, and he has Tennessee on the board to start this game.
It's Paris Harrelson from Flora, Mississippi. Touchdown, 7-6.
Commercial, I think it was the right tackle, Kyle Tatum, the youngest guy on that offensive line that had the mistake.
Here's the kick, Brandon Brooks, 5 yards deep, touchdown, touchback. And let's go back to the touchdown.
We'll take a look at the right side of the offensive line. Here's Kyle Tatum. Now the right guard is going to pull. He's got to cut this man off here to eliminate that kind of penetration. He hesitates for a second, and he gets confused, and McBride went right past his inside and made the play in the backfield. You can't allow penetration against your running game, and that was just a miscommunication up front and a misstep and a misplay by Kyle Tatum. Again, the only sophomore up on that offensive line.
This is Turk McBride, who forced the fumble. Spencer Pennington. Kim Castillo, the fullback, starts in motion. Draw play. Darby, nothing there. Back to the 20. Kevin Burnett, number two, made the tackle. And let's take a look at the Alabama starting offensive lineup presented by the Hartford. Britt Mathis, Klausner, Danny Martz, and Kyle Tatum, the right tackle. Kenneth Darby, Tim Castile in the backfield. Prothrow and Cadell of the wideouts, and Clint Johnston is the tight end. Mike Shula, 39 years of age, second year as the Alabama head coach. His father and stepmother are here today. Don Shula, present at the game. DJ Hall is the motion man. Here's Pennington. And that one's complete to Castile out to the 26-yard line. There's a bobbled ball, but well, let's see. Tennessee is claiming they've got it.
Now they're marking it down.
Okay. Tennessee defense, you saw Burnett make that tackle. He's an outstanding outside linebacker. Up front, Harrelson, who got the touchdown. McBride, who forced the fumble. Harrell and Neal, they will miss Jesse Mahalona today out with the knee. Omar Gaither, Jason Mitchell, Kevin Burnett, the linebackers, and the secondary. There is a young starter, Gerard Parrish, number 19, replacing Brandon Johnson, who had two interceptions last week in the win at Ole Miss, was indefinitely suspended for firing a gun in the air on Sunday night. This one behind Keith Brown, the intended receiver.
And he had him. You know, that's a throw that Spencer Pennington's going to have to make throughout this game. Because he had his man one-on-one. It would have been an easy first down conversion. And he's got to make an accurate throw on a third down play like that.
Bo Freeland on the punt on fourth and four. They've changed punt return men now for Tennessee. Derek Tinsley is back. Jonathan Heppney, who had been doing those chores, had a muffed punt return last week at the Ole Miss 24-yard line. So here's Tinsley. He has returned two this season. Oh, boy, they got in on that one. Good penetration. And this is off the side of Freeland's foot and will come to rest after being touched at the 48-yard line. That's a 26-yard punt for Freeland.
Now, this is not a real positive beginning for Alabama. Turnover on their first possession, a punt on their next one, and a near block of a punt. And anytime that guy gets in there, even if he doesn't get the football, it affects the vision of the punter. Bo Freeland certainly affected on that one.
Spencer Pennington on the bench. Tennessee's got the ball.
He screams for a shot down the field. Good field position and a lead to start their first possession.
First down and 10. They will hand it off left side. It's Gerald Riggs, who is getting his third consecutive start. And Jeremy Clark, number 99, makes the tackle. Let's check this Tennessee offense, led by Eric Ames. 6'6", 18-year-old up front. Munoz, Rob Smith, who's playing great. Respert, Aaron Sears, and Albert Tawina. Cody Douglas, an injured guard, will not play today. Riggs and Anderson in the backfield. Tony Brown, Chris Hannon, Victor McClure gets the start. Wow, there's a penetration. My goodness. D'Amico Ryans, number 35. Whap.
Well, D'Amico Ryans, we know he can tackle, a very fundamental football player. He's going to come from out of your picture. He came on a little bit of a run blitz and nobody accounted for him, and he just timed it perfectly. So often when you blitz, the timing is critical. That was perfect by Ryans.
Third and nine. Here's the audible now from Eric Ainge. D'Amico Ryans, who led this team in tackles a year ago, including one game against Arkansas when he had 25. Here's Ainge back, lobs it over the middle. Chris Hannon cannot get it. Flag is down.
Late flag.
They might get Anthony Madison for this one.
I don't know. This ball was thrown. I don't know if it was a catchable pass or not. Now, Anthony Madison is playing with a broken bone in his left wrist. And so he's a little limited with that left hand. There is, well, he did have a hold of the right jersey. So a good call on the holding. He did have a hold of the shoulder pad with his right hand. There's the left hand with the broken bone in the wrist. He was grabbing with the right hand. And one of the things for these cornerbacks, they're 5'10 and 5'9. They've got to be physical with these big Tennessee receivers. And you got to use your hands, but you got to do it legally.
Now, Steve Landis is the referee, and he has not yet made public the infraction. Expect that he will here shortly.
Well, we still have a little discussion here. These two corners, Madison and Ramsey Robinson, have played extremely well this season, but this will be their toughest challenge. Tall receivers of Tennessee with a lot of athletic ability and a quarterback, a gifted quarterback in Eric Ainge.
Madison is listed at 5'9", and on the other side, Ramsey Robinson, you see him, he's 5'10", and this Tennessee bunch has seven receivers 6'1", or taller.
Yeah. The number one pass defense in the conference. They're going to say this.
The pass interference foul occurred less than 15 yards from the line of scrimmage. Therefore, it's a spot foul. It's still a first down.
Yeah, so they just took off a little of the yardage. There's the difference in the height. And, you know, that's not that uncommon. We've seen a real trend with tall receivers, and it's hard to find tall corners. Shorter corners have to be physical at the line of scrimmage with those taller guys.
Ball at the 40, first down. They fake the reverse, hand it off to Riggs. And He runs into Todd Bates, number 56, one of the down linemen for this Crimson Tide bunch. And let's introduce you to them. Todd Bates, Rudy Griffin, Jeremy Clark, and Mark Anderson. The linebackers, Freddie Roach, who moves to the weak side linebacker spot, Cornelius Wortham. And then in the secondary, Robinson, Harper, Pepperell, Madison. Here's Ames across the middle, dropped by Victor McClure, the tight end.
See, if I was Alabama playing defense, and Joe Kynes knows it, when they're in that set with just two wide receivers and a tight end, I'd play cover two and double up the outside receivers. Tennessee has not shown that they have a tight end, particularly Victor McClure, that's a threat as a receiver. That ball was thrown in a place he could have caught it, didn't make the catch. Joe Kynes has got to be pleased with the way his defense has played this year, ranked number one in total defense in the SEC.
Another third down, last timeout on third and nine. They got the pass interference call. And here is Eric Ainge with the chains. Looks back at Riggs, makes sure he's got it. Ainge back, stunts, not a lot of pressure. Pass is too high. They intended for Tony Brown, and incomplete. Roman Harper was there to defend.
Well, you take a look at what Alabama has done defensively through their first seven games. Rushing yards, they've given up the most, but everything else, I mean, they've been outstanding. Now, the quality of opponent has not been as strong as what they're facing today. They played one Division I AA team in Western Carolina and some other teams that aren't offensive juggernauts, to say the least. But this is a good challenge for them today.
Here's the lefty, Dustin Colquitt. Leader career now in number of punts, and this one is sky high. That almost gets as high as the upper deck, and a fair catch is taken.
That went higher than it did far, I'll guarantee
you
that.
18 yards. Yeah. That was 36 yards up and 18 yards long. Time call, 7-0. First down from the 21-yard line, just across the 20. Spencer Pennington, double fullbacks as Castile spends a lot of time at the tailback position, especially after Ray Hudson went down with the injury a week and a half ago. So Castile moves over to tailback on this play.
Well, he plays a lot of both. I mean, he's more of a physical threat. Plus, with Hudson being out, they've got to keep Darby fresh, and that's the way they do it. But first down is critical for Alabama today. They've got to gain some yards on first down. They haven't done too well so far. 6 yards on three tries on first down so far.
Second down and nine, Jesse Mahalona, who's been a star the last 2 weeks. And here's a reverse to Tyrone Prothrow. And my goodness, did Jason Allen do a great job of reading it and staying close.
Yep, he sure did. And he did a great job of getting down into a football position and maintaining his leverage, not allowing the guy to get outside. Jason Allen started the year as a corner. Here he is. Watch him come outside and then just keep him to his inside. And that's what you have to do. If you're on the edge, if you have perimeter contained, you've got to get outside of him and force him back in where your help is. That's a beautifully played by Jason Allen.
Well, now Tennessee playing to its strength. They've got Mahalona in there. Pennington, inexperienced as a quarterback, looks at third and nine.
And this is why that first down is so critical. Third down and five or less, they could run or throw. This is pure pass.
He's got a lot of time. He goes deep left side, and he overthrows the receiver who throws. Moment was open. That was Keith Brown. They will punt, and we will go back and spend a moment with Tim Brando in New York.
Vern, I've got your SEC shocker of the year. Chris Leak is picked off here by strong safety Jeremy Johnson. I guess a little banjo coverage. And watch Jarius Norwood. He's had a huge second half. 37 yards, two touchdowns overall, 174 yards. Sylvester Crew may be getting his first SEC victory against Florida.
No.
I don't know what I'm more surprised about, that upset or Timmy B breaking out the banjo coverage.
Here's the pressure. They get the punt away. Freeland, fair catch called by Derek Tinsley. And it comes at the 42-yard line, a 38-yard punt, and nothing on the return. We're midway through quarter number one, Neyland Stadium in Knoxville. And the balls are up by seven. 8:34 to go. Opening quarter, 7-0. began to sprinkle a little bit, so they had the ball covered during most of the timeout.
Quarterbacks love that. You know, you don't like that ball getting wet.
First down and 10. Here's Ames. They fake the reverse again. Tony Brown coming around. They give it off to Riggs. And he runs into Cornelius Wortham. We go down to Tracy Wolfson.
Thanks, Vern. I had a chance to speak with Colts quarterback Peyton Manning a few weeks ago about Eric Ainge, and he said he was very impressed at how poised he was for an 18-year-old and that he really enjoys watching him play. Well, he got the chance last week to see him in person when Tennessee faced Ole Miss. During the pregame, they caught up for the first time in the locker room, talked a little football. Ainge told us yesterday Manning is as good, if not a better guy than he thought he was, and a very good role model, one he said he's looked up to for years.
Quite a moment for an 18-year-old. Quite a moment for a 26-year-old. And one is picked off.
Yep, sure was.
In and out of the hands of Tony Brown and into the hands of D'Amico Ryans.
Well, Alabama had the turnover on their first possession. Tennessee turned it into points. Now Alabama comes up with a big turnover. +7 in the turnover ratio coming into today's game. Their 8th interception on the season. This was just a bobbled ball by Tony Brown. Good throw. And D'Amico Ryans with a hustle play getting to the football.
Well, that's going to go as the 7th interception of the season against Eric Ainge, but put that one all on Tony Brown.
That's right.
First down and 10. Here's the handoff to Kenneth Garvey down inside the 40 to 38. I'm just thinking about something that Eric Ainge told us yesterday about his conversation with Peyton Manning. And he said one of the pieces of advice that Manning gave to him was, every interception has a story. Yeah. Your responsibility as a quarterback is to take responsibility.
That's right. It's not to try to explain what happened on every interception, because balls get tipped, balls get bobbled, just like that one. It goes down in the books as his interception. But as you mentioned, really more the fault of Tony Brown, if anybody.
0-for-3 in the early going. His team leads it by 7. Lawan McClain is in at fullback now in front of Darby. Leads the way left side. Darby breaks into the secondary, and he's got an Alabama first down at the 34.
And see, this is what Alabama has done successfully this season. First down, they get 6 yards. Then they come back and run it on second and short when they could throw or run, and they get a first down. I think the key to this Alabama offense is the 3 seniors on their offensive line, and they've got 2 outstanding fullbacks. Laron McClain and Tim Castile are both excellent lead blocking fullbacks for Alabama.
That is the first Alabama first down. It comes at the 34-yard line. Timeout.
Yeah, Alabama.
Alabama.
It. Mike Shula called it from the sideline.
An 18-yard fumble return. Timeout.
They've got to hit a few passes. They don't have to throw it 30 times, but they have to pass with some effectiveness.
Here's Pennington, and there's an effective pass into the hands of Clint Johnson, number 88. At the 24-yard line, we go back once again. Here's Tim.
Vernon Todd, freshman bookends, Chad Henney and Michael Hart getting together for this balanced Michigan offense. Now watch closely, because this play is going to be ruled down at the 1-yard line, but they reviewed it. You can do that in the Big Ten, and they overturned it, giving him the touchdown to make it 7-7. By the way, Mississippi State did close out Florida 38-31. Congratulations to Sylvester Krum.
Indeed, congratulations, Tim. We pass him along as well. And boy, will there be noise in the system in Gainesville this week. Wow. Here's Pennington, play fake. Deep left corner, pro throws wide open. Has to wait forever on the ball. Oh, my goodness, they had 6.
And see, when you're out there on an island as a cornerback, the way Rashawn Fellows was, you've got to protect the post. You can't get beat inside to the post with no safety help. And so he favored the inside, and that allowed Prothro, when he broke outside, to be wide open. But Pennington, a little cautious on the throw, didn't throw it early enough, didn't have enough on the football. Otherwise, easy touchdown for the Crimson Tide.
That's a 22-yard pass completion. Prothro's 11th of the season.
Alabama 16 rushing touchdowns coming into today.
Here's Castile.
Make it 17.
Bangs over for the score. Danny Martz, number 79, pulled and led the way.
Yep. You've got three centers, seniors in there. Danny Marks, the right guard. Evan Mathis, the left guard. Wesley Britt, the left tackle. And that's right where they ran the football with Big Tim Castillo.
That is the sixth rushing touchdown for Castillo this year. Brian Bostic on for the equalizing extra point. Alex Fox will hold it. We're tied at seven.
Spencer Pennington hit two big passes in that drive, and then Tim Castillo finished it off. Alabama ties it up 7-7 here in Knoxville.
Jamie Christensen is the kickoff specialist, a redshirt freshman, and he's plunked 15 of his 42 kickoffs into the end zone. This will not be one of them. This is taken at the 10-yard line by Robert Boulware, and he's out near the 22-yard line.
We'll go back to the touchdown. Some excellent blocks on this play. Right here, the tight end, Clint Johnson. Danny March is going to come through and get a big block. And then the fullback, LaRon McClain, is going to get a knockout block on the end. Watch this execution by the offensive line in the backs. Tight end, guard, fullback, crushing block. And Castillo, a 230-pound tailback, crashes into the end zone. But Spencer Pennington, again, a great confidence builder on that drive. Two big completions to get him near the end zone.
First down from the 22-yard line. Here's Ainge, who's yet to hit his first pass play. Riggs is belted by Freddie Roach, number eight. And Todd Bates was there as well. Roach, who's moved to the outside. Jawan Garth, the weak side linebacker, has missed the last couple of games. Roach, the backup middle linebacker, moved outside and has done more than an adequate job. He has played superbly.
And one of the things that's really helped Alabama is they've got a little more depth on their defensive line this year that they've had, so they're able to rotate some different guys in there. They're playing seven and eight guys as opposed to just four or five like they've done in years past.
Loss in the play. Here's Ainge back to throw. Bounces to Nico Ryans, put some pressure on him, and it's thrown away incomplete. Ryans was all over him.
And they very easily caught it, could have caught a holding, because I think D'Amico Ryans got held at the end of that rush. Gerald Riggs was the guy responsible for trying to block D'Amico Ryans coming on that blitz, and got away with a little bit of a hold there. Take a look at the end of this play. Here's Riggs blocking on Ryans, and as he tries to change directions, Riggs grabs a hold of him and anyway, forced the throw away. So good play by D'Amico.
Third and 11. This is another third and long that Alabama has forced Tennessee to confront. Hand it off, Riggs, wide open, deception play. A hold is going to bring it back.
Wow, tough penalty. It's going to go on Aaron Sears, the right guard. They really fooled Alabama with that play. It's a misdirection draw where the quarterback starts to his left and they hand it back and run it out the backside. A well-designed play, good call by offensive coordinator Randy Sanders, but Aaron Sears is going to get flagged for the hold.
Aaron Sears, a sophomore out of Melbourne, Florida, who has played quite well this year.
Aaron Sears started the season as a tackle. Here he is right here, playing the right guard, blocking on Chris Harris. He's got those hands on the outside, and then the hand goes to the back, and that's a takedown. And that's a good call, and really he didn't need to finish the block at that point because Riggs was already by him.
Number 45 of the offense, 10-yard penalty, repeat third down.
Well, that wipes out a 12-yard gain and a first down for Tennessee. Results in a third and 20 from the 12. Three wideouts, two to the left, one to the right. Brett Smith, there's a draw play. They keep it conservative, and Riggs is knocked down by Roman Harper.
I'll tell you what, this Alabama defense is playing with tremendous confidence. You know, a lot of these guys are the same guys that played on the Alabama defense last year, but sometimes it's more important if you think you're good than if you actually are good, because these guys believe they're a great defense, and they're playing like that. And one of the things that's helped them is good field position and playing, making an offense go a long field against them. Alabama should get great field position here.
Here's Dustin Colquitt. This one, a good one.
Great and kick.
What a terrific kick out of bounds. Right at the 40-yard line. 50-yard punt. The 208th of his career. That's number one all time. Get complete college football coverage at CBS Sportsline. And a reminder, fantasy basketball leagues are forming now. Get in on the action by clicking on fantasy basketball at CBSSportsline.com. Turnovers even at one apiece. A fumble return for a touchdown by Paris Harrelson of Tennessee, 45 seconds in. D'Amico Ryan's got an interception that led to the Alabama touchdown, and the Crimson Tide has the ball. Here's Darby, gets a block in the corner, and then surges across the 45-yard line. Tackle made by Gerard Parrish.
And that is a win for Alabama. If they can gain 5 yards or more on first down, that puts them in prime situation. One of the real keys for Tennessee on their defense today is to control first down, to hold them to 1-2 yard gains on first down and make them play behind the chains. If Alabama can play second and five or better, then they really have the advantage with this offensive line and this running game.
Darby and McClain behind Pennington. Darby got a little wiggle to him, doesn't he?
Yeah, he does. He does. I think that, you know, he and Ray Hudson were pretty much interchangeable, and Sparky Woods, the running back coach, just kind of rotated them by feel. I think if you compare the two, that Darby has maybe a little bit more shake to him than Hudson did. Hudson maybe a little bigger, maybe a little bit faster, but Darby a little bit more ability to make people miss in the box.
See his effectiveness last week at home against Southern Miss. 3 yards shy of 200, his first start. And Tennessee has gone to 5 down linemen now.
First time they've shown this all season, first time they've shown it in this ballgame.
Darby might be enough for another first down. Across the 50 it is, as Kevin Burnett, number 2, makes the stop.
I expected that we would see a lot of this 5 defensive linemen set up for Alabama or for Tennessee, not just in obvious short yardage situations because of Alabama's style of running the football. Back to a 4-man line now, and again, this is Alabama football. Run it, control the clock, and then hit a few key passes to make that defense be honest.
Castile is the tailback. Pennington wants to throw it deep right side. He goes deep for DJ Hall. That's a jump ball, and it's knocked incomplete at the 11-yard line by Rashawn Fellows, number 36.
Nice play by Fellows. Again, a little bit of an underthrow that time by Pennington. He's got to get that ball in the air in a hurry and let his man make the play. Now, it's okay sometimes. One-on-one, throw that ball up there and let your receiver have a chance to make a play. DJ Hall is 6'3". Rashawn Fellows is 6 foot. Throw that ball up there and let him go up and be a basketball player and come down with the football.
Second and 10. Castile stays in the backfield. Keith Brown, top of your screen. And this is Johnston, the tight end, in motion. They'll run it to Castile. Spins out of one tackle, but right into the arms of Kevin Burnett, who came back this year. Had a red shirt 2 years ago when he was injured in the first game, and Burnett came back. He didn't feel like he played all that well last year, and wanted to enhance his post-collegiate opportunities.
Well, he's playing well this year. He really is. You see 51 tackles. He was named one of 12 semifinalists for the Butkus Award this week. And he's been a good senior leader of this Tennessee defense.
Third and 7. On third down and plus 6, they run 51% of the time. This time they throw it, and Prothro's got the first down.
Wow, nifty bit of running after the catch by Prothro. He didn't have the first down when he made the catch, but he shows his shiftiness and his ability to get the ball back inside for the first down. Last year in the game in Tuscaloosa was really kind of the coming out party for Tyrone Prothro. He hadn't played much coming into that game. Came in, had some big catches, played well in the overtime loss. Good protection up front by the front 5. Only a 4-man rush. Pennington stays in there, and then Prothro just nifty and shifty running for the first down.
Pennington has completed 4. And he hands it off to Darby again. Darby breaks through. Hefney is up around the shoulders to make the tackle, but a fine piece of running again, Todd, on first down.
Yeah, really good running. I mean, just good patience by Darby, just sitting in there and waiting behind March. Now watch, March is going to pull and lead on this, the right guard again, Watch as he gets around here. Darby's just going to follow. He's just going to kind of sit in there behind his fullback, behind his guard, and just wait until something opens up. That is excellent running by Ken Darby, being patient with the football.
Gain of 7, second down and 3. And as the quarter nears its conclusion, Alabama threatens to score again. Slip it to the fullback. McClain breaks a tackle. First down inside the 20.
I think these two fullbacks are the best I've seen all season, both of them, McClain and Castillo, both as runners, as blockers, and as catching the football out of the backfield. Good blocking on the right side, and then just hard, tough running by McClain, breaking a tackle and adding about 7 more yards.
That will be the final play of the first quarter. Well, Tennessee scored in the first series. They returned a fumble 18 yards for a touchdown. Since then, offensively, nada for the Volunteers, and Alabama has tied it at 7, and they're threatening. That's the end of one. We'll return to Neyland Stadium after this message and a word from your local stylist, Todd Blackledge, Tracy Wolfson. And a first down 10, Alabama in a tie game. They've got this first down at the 18 of the Volunteers. Darby the setback, McClain the fullback, Pennington draw play. And Darby squirts through and is down inside the 15 at the 14-yard line. Well, if you joined us late, in the first minute, an 18-yard fumble return for a touchdown. Yeah. Great resiliency by this Alabama team.
Yeah, I think the real key was their defense stopped Tennessee on the second possession. When Tennessee had good field position again, they forced a punt. The third possession, they got the interception, and now the Alabama offense starting to control the line of scrimmage. 91 yards to 1 yard in that first quarter. They dominated action. They held the ball, and right now they're threatening again.
Gain of 4 in the last play. See the first quarter numbers. First down, 6-1. And here's the handoff to Darby. He's caught behind the line. Burnett is the second man there. The penetration made down low by Jesse Mahalona, who has just been terrific the last 2 weeks. And Mahalona is playing on a badly sprained knee.
I think that's the only second time that the Tennessee defense has gotten penetration, and both times something good has happened. They got the fumble when McBride got the penetration. That time, a loss of yardage running play for Alabama, bringing up third and long from the 18-yard line. This is where Spencer Pennington needs to be very smart. I wouldn't be surprised to see him run the football here.
Third and 9. He will throw. He gets good protection. He goes in the end zone. Prothro has it tipped away by Rashawn Fellows.
Boy, I don't know if Fellows got a hand on the ball or not. It looked like Prothro got both hands on the football. This is a good throw by Pennington. Yeah, he did. He did get his hand in there. Nice play by Rashawn Fellows. Man-to-man coverage, the post route, tough to defend. Did a nice job there. The redshirt freshman, two freshman cornerbacks for Tennessee in the ballgame, Fellows and Hefney.
That brings on Brian Bostic, the senior from Coleman, Alabama, 34-yarder. He's 8 of 11 for the season. Alex Fox will hold. Drew Lane will snap it back just to break the tie.
5 of 6 from this range of the field.
Good snap. The hold is down and the kick, perfection. Quite an impressive drive by Alabama. I'm sure they're unhappy, and a flag is down now at the 18-yard line. And Steve Landis is going to let the other guys discuss this one. Looks like the Red Sox Yankees, but not quite as much on the line, at least yet. Here's Landis.
There is no foul on the play. Point is good.
I guess we'll never know what it might have been. To our chagrin, it's 10-7. Philip Fulmer's team trails by 3. Corey Larkins is back to return it, and Christensen will kick it off. Mentioned 15 touchbacks this season. Earlier in the year, he had problems with kicking it out of bounds. He's done that 7 times. This one, there you are, touchback. He's quite a weapon. And it's time now for the much anticipated
Aflac
trivia question of the week.
Aflac.
Who's oh, it's a double. Who started the Alabama-Tennessee victory cigar tradition and who supplied the cigars?
Well, I'll tell you, first down, the key in this game for both teams. Alabama's ability to gain yards, Tennessee's ability to defend it, and right now a huge edge for Alabama being productive on first down.
Cedric Houston, his first appearance in the game. Here's a play fake, and Ainge fires it deep behind the intended receiver, Derek Tinsley, who was all by himself.
But that's a tough throw for the right-handed quarterback throwing back to the middle. That's one where Eric Ainge probably should just run the football. He's out there. He's got some room. He might pick up 5 yards. They're struggling to gain anything on first down. Tinsley is open, but this is not an easy throw by any means for any quarterback.
Eric Ainge is still looking for his first completion in the ball game. The 6'6 freshman, 18-year-olders. Mom and dad are here. His grandparents are here as well today. Don Ainge and his wife. Here's Ainge. There's the first completion. And flag. Nope, no flag. Something came flying.
Yeah, that was a football on the sideline.
Okay.
I think.
Well, it was a brown flag. Let's go back to New York. Spend a moment with Tim Brando.
Vern, if you were with us on the College Football Today, you heard Archie Manning and myself talking about what a stabilizing force Wyatt Sexton was. And then Spencer Tillman said, you know, they're really relying more on the ground game. Well, I think Spencer was right. Sexton picked off by Matt Robinson, 18 yards. Wake with the lead, 7-0.
All right, thank you, Tim. Third and 5 here. Flip complete. Tony Brown, that's a first down at the 32-yard line. Gain of 7. Charlie Peppra made the tackle. Well, Eric's mom and dad, Doug and Diane, have made the trip for every game. Well, Diane was not here last week. But Doug and Diane have come back from Portland, Oregon.
Do you think Diane bought that hat in Portland?
I don't think so.
I don't either.
And granddad, Don Ainge, is here as well. And, of course, Doug Ainge, a basketball player at Brigham Young University. Danny Ainge, Doug's brother, great star in the NBA and now chief executive with the Boston Celtics. Danny is not here. And here's Houston. Well, Eric Ainge had a great game last week against Ole Miss. Go back a few years and remember Danny Ainge when he played basketball at BYU.
Ainge under center.
Ainge brings it up.
Ainge back to throw.
He crossed the timeline.
Three-step drop. Sets up.
All the way through.
Lobs the ball for the end zone. Man wide open. Touchdown, Tennessee.
Quite a moment. Ainge and Ainge. Generation apart, and D'Amico Ryans makes the tackle here on Cedric Houston.
You know, Tracy was talking about when she talked to Peyton Manning and how Peyton mentioned Eric Ainge's poise, and that's the thing that stands out to me about him, his poise, his calmness under pressure, and his ability to overcome adversity. Something bad happens, throws an interception against Ole Miss, return for a touchdown, comes right back on the field and leads him 83 yards down the field. So this little bit of adversity early in this game is not going to shake up this young quarterback.
Third and 2, a 10-7 Alabama lead in the second quarter. Here comes the rush, and Ainge throws it away, and that will be intentional grounding. Not outside the tackle box.
Well, I thought there was a receiver in the area, though. I mean, he didn't get out of the tackle box, but the ball did get across the line of scrimmage.
Okay.
Here comes the blitz right here. Nobody's going to pick him up. I think it was Freddie Roach coming on the blitz, unblocked. Okay, if the ball didn't get past the line of scrimmage, then it would be called intentional ground. If it got past the line of scrimmage, there was a receiver in the area.
I think he's
picking
it up.
There is no penalty. Pass is
incomplete. That's a good call.
Fourth down.
And Mike Shula seems reasonably certain of the call. It was on third down, so it'll bring up fourth.
A mistake by Tennessee, though, not to pick up Freddie Roach because nobody accounted for him. It was not an all-out blitz, but Roach came unblocked.
Dustin Colquitt's third punt, and Brandon Brooks awaits it inside the 15.
This is where Ole Miss faked a punt last week, or Tennessee against Ole Miss. Penalty marker down.
Yep.
Ramsey Robinson was trying to bait him by sneaking in. Last week when Tennessee played Ole Miss, Ole Miss tried to sneak in late. And And Craig Colquitt, or Dustin Colquitt, saw it and did this on his own. I mean, he just made the call and threw it out to Chris Hannon for a big first down conversion. And that time, Alabama was trying to bait them into doing the same thing, and it resulted in a 5-yard penalty for Tennessee.
False start. Mark it back to the 39. Meacham was out here. He's one of the gunners. Now they're up to check both gunners. And Colquitt will punt it. Line drive, poor punt. Bounces at the 30, gets a great Tennessee roll, but a chance for the return.
Block in the back. Yeah, this one's coming back. That was an obvious block in the back. The first block was okay. The second one was not okay.
That was Marcel Stamps, who was deep on the return team. 47-yard punt. 10 on the return, but this one's going to go south.
And this field position will really turn out for Tennessee. It wasn't a very good punt, but the penalty is going to back Alabama up, and Tennessee able to flip the field with field position. Yeah, take a look. Right here is the penalty. That's Marcel Stamps, as you called, with the block in the back right in the middle of the return. And Alabama will start inside their 15-yard line.
Officially at the 13. And Spencer Pennington and the offense getting ready to come back on with 10:42 to go. Time has been called, and CBS Sports coverage of the Home Depot SEC on CBS continues after this word from your local station. From the 13, first down and 10. High formation behind Spencer Pennington. Johnston, the tight end, in motion. And here's Darby, almost broken. And time now for the Argent Mortgage quarterback comparison. Brody Croyle out with a knee in the third game. Pennington and Gillen since then.
Yeah. And he was off to such a good start. The one thing for Spencer Pennington, though, he's the only quarterback on the roster with a winning record as a starting quarterback. Brody Croyle, 7-9 in his career. Spencer Pennington got one start last year, a losing effort to Georgia. 2-0 as a starter this year, and doing a nice job so far today against Tennessee.
Second down and 6, gain of 4 on the first down play. There's the pulling guard, and Darby out to the 19-yard line. And for more on Spencer Pennington, let's check in with Tracy Wolfson. Trace?
Thanks, guys. Since Pennington took over at quarterback, Brody Croyle has been giving him advice on plays, road games, and crowd noise. I asked Croyle earlier this week what he told him about playing in Neyland's hostile environment, and he just laughed. He said, in terms of handling the crowd noise, you can't prepare for that. He told Pennington, people tell you once you get there, you can't hear the crowd. But this is not true at all. He told him, just go out there, manage the game, communicate with your guys, and let them know you're in control.
All right, Trace, thank you. The penalty against Tennessee, Steve Landis. Pennington from Fayette, Alabama. Brody Croyle from Rainbow City, Alabama. They came in together, and Pennington said, he is my best friend in the world.
Big hunting buddies.
Yeah. Like you and I are.
Yeah, get out in the outdoors. We hunt for barbecue
turkeys.
Restaurants.
Turkeys. That's what
we
Darby showing a little elusiveness, and out to the 31. Well, Spencer Pennington was offered an opportunity to come to Alabama by Dennis Franchione. He's a baseball player as well. There you see the very final moments of his only home run.
He's going to play baseball again this spring. You know, he didn't play after his first year because Mike Price, or he played his first year, then Mike Price didn't want him to play when he was there as the head coach. Last year he was rehabbing a shoulder injury that he sustained in that Georgia game, and he wasn't healthy enough to play, but he's going to play this spring, and Mike Shula has given him the okay for that.
Here's a play fake. Pennington back, goes deep for pro throw. He's got the inside position, and the pass is overthrown by 5 yards.
When you play a team like this, and they know you can run, they're going to take some chances. They're going to crowd the line of scrimmage and give you some opportunities to throw the ball downfield. You don't have to hit all of them, but you need to hit some of them. And that was a good opportunity for Spencer Pennington, just a little long on the throw.
And it's going to set up a third and short. Pennington came out of high school with the opportunity to go into baseball. He was actually flown up to Boston by the Red Sox and got a chance to take batting practice, wore the Red Sox uniform. So you can imagine he is a bit euphoric, not only by the fact that Alabama has this lead, but the fact that game one of the World Series is going to be played in Fenway tonight. Spencer Pennington, his team leads by 3 midway through the second. 4 wideouts, 1 running back, no tight ends, and Pennington the quarterback. Quick setup, comes out of the backfield, and that one is to Ezekiel Knight, number 84. And I don't believe he got enough.
No, I think he's going to be a hair short. Ezekiel Knight is a big, young receiver, 6'3", 210 pounds, and a very physical tackle right on the sideline. A safe pass tonight, a little arrow route. You want him to turn up field and get the first down, but just a hard hit. Is that Hefney?
Yes.
Nice play by the freshman cornerback coming up and making a solid tackle right at the point of the catch.
Now, the crowd's a little restless. They thought this was a favorable spot for Alabama. Well, we'll see. They bring the chain all the way across.
Yeah, I think they needed to bring the chains because the chains were on the opposite side of the field, a little bit hard to eyeball it from there.
Whoa.
And it's a good thing they did bring them.
Whoa.
Alabama was running their punt team on the field before the officials stopped. I mean, they were ready to punt the football.
My, my, my.
Ezekiel Knight tries to turn up field and a huge hit up high by Hefney. If he hits him low, Knight probably falls forward for the easy first down. He hit him up around the chest, but Alabama's still able to get a very, very close first down. Mm.
First and 10, just outside the 34. They'll officially call this the 35. They fake the reverse again, about the third time they've run that play. And Darby runs into Carlton Neal. Go back and take a look at this, Todd.
Well, they're running the punt team in because this official initially held up his fist saying fourth down. And then he decided, look, here it is. He's holding up the fist, fourth down. Alabama's running the punt team on. And they say, wait a minute, let's maybe we should take a look at this.
And there is a player down.
Evan Mathis.
Evan Mathis,
yeah,
oh
the
boy.
Left guard.
Now, last year in this game, we saw Wesley Britt, his longtime friend and colleague on the front line, out with a fractured leg in the first quarter of the game. There's Wesley Britt, provided all of us with one of the most memorable moments in college sports when he urged, and he and Evan Mathis have been starters on that left side for 83 games.
Well, the penetration by Kevin Burnett, number 2, is what causes the injury. And you can see right as Burnett comes in, he falls on the left leg of Evan Mathis. It looked like he was able to pull it out fast enough, and that's good to see him walking off the field under his own power.
Yep. Senior from Homewood, Alabama, 10-7 time called. They put him under and operated. Second down, Pennington back. Left side, tip, nice play. Oh, boy. Hefney, number 33.
Jonathan Hefney is going to be a great corner, I think, here at Tennessee. He's a very young guy, played last year at Hargrave Military Academy up in Virginia. He's got really nice cover skills. Also a dangerous return man. Read that one all the way. Didn't get fooled at all by the route and was there to knock it away. Third and long now for Alabama.
And good news for Alabama, Evan Mathis is back in at left guard. So, did step out of the way in time. Kim Castile is the running back, Pennington. See if Tennessee's coming. They do bring the blitz, man coverage. And Keith Brown has to turn around. He did. Boy, did he ever.
You know, this is just a ball that Spencer just didn't put in a good place because Keith Brown ran by Hefney on this one. I think, you know, Hefney squatted on the last route and made the play on the out route. This time he stayed there and Brown went right past him, but Pennington threw the ball out of bounds. Again, you're going to get shots down the field. You've got to hit a couple of them if you want to win a game like this. You don't have to hit every one, but you've got to hit some of them down the field.
Fourth and 9, Derek Tinsley awaits the punt of Bo Freeland. And he's inside the 25-yard line. Tinsley moves up, grabs it, avoids the first contact, has some room. Here we go. Looks for Brocks. gets him down at the 29. On the punt, 45 on the return, by far the longest punt return for Tennessee this year.
And coming into the game, ninth in the SEC in punt returns, averaging just a little bit over 5 yards per return. Phillip Fulmer opting to go with the change to Tinsley, a guy who can make people miss. You got to make the first guy miss, which he did. And then just an excellent bit of open field running and vision by Derek Tinsley. Has been a running back, has been a wide receiver during his career, now a dangerous return man.
On first down, Eric Ainge fires it, dropped. Jason Swain, maybe a little bit behind him, but yeah. I think a catchable ball.
Well, that was a hard catch. That was not a very well-thrown ball, I don't think, by Eric Ainge. I mean, he can throw the ball a lot more accurately than that. They went for the big pass play on first down. And again, when you're struggling a little bit, whether you're a young quarterback or a veteran quarterback, sometimes you try to aim the ball instead of just getting back there and cutting it loose.
Now you saw 2 of 9 and a quarter and a half for Eric Ainge. Total yardage, this is astounding to me. 21 yards for Tennessee so far in the game. 21. Quick setup. Down to the right side. Swain makes this catch and gets out of the tackle and moves it down inside the 20. Charlie Pepper. Now remember the decision that Phillip Fulmer made before the season began to name his two 18-year-old freshmen as co-starters. C.J. Leak was the starter at that time. Rick Clawson the backup. And Schaefer actually started the first couple of games this year. We've not seen him in this ball game. He played in only 2 series last Saturday night. And they will bring the chain across now to see if they got the first down. Brent Schaefer out of Deerfield Beach in Florida. 234 yards, 2 touchdowns, and an interception.
And see, the real burden for Brent Schaefer right now is to not allow himself to get discouraged. He's got to stay with it. He can't feel sorry for himself because he's not playing as much as he did earlier. He's got to keep preparing as if he is the starter, because right now he's one injury, one play away from being the guy again for this Tennessee offense.
First down and 10 after the measurement, and here's Ainge. Corey Anderson, number 45, who's a loaded fullback, 270 pounds. He's been really an effective blocker and pass receiver. Out of the backfield. There's the inside route. Touchdown, Tennessee. Jason Swain, who grew up in Huntsville, Alabama.
Showed their blitz too early on this play. Eric Ainge saw it. He backed away. He audibled to the quick throw. Alabama stayed with the blitz, and Eric Ainge made him pay for it.
James Wilhite with the extra point. Up and good. Set up by a 45-yard punt return from Derek Tinsley.
One-on-one coverage. Jason Swain uses his strength to get inside of Madison right away, and then an accurate throw by Eric Ainge to beat Anthony Madison. Tennessee leads 14-10 with 6:40 left in the half.
Eric Ainge, Brent Schaefer, Tony Brown, the senior co-captain, one of six. Ainge is explaining, the 18-year-old explaining to the senior, here's what we did and how we did it.
Yeah.
Well, he really is, Todd, remarkable. Look at the rubber bands on each wrist. Those are for Dan Marley and his uncle Danny Ainge. They used to wear rubber bands at practice with the Phoenix Suns. Eric used to go down and watch him. He's worn rubber bands ever since. Got one left, one right. He's amphibious after all.
Mm-hmm.
Wilhoit will kick off. 14-10 Tennessee. Brandon Brooks moves up, grabs it at the 5. At the 25. At the 30.
I want to go back to the touchdown You remember the big punt return by Derek Tinsley, gave him field position. This is what Ainge saw. At first, Alabama is showing like an umbrella coverage, looks like zone, but then at the last minute, he's gonna see blitz look coming up. So once he sees the blitz, now he's gonna back away and he's gonna change the play. He's gonna make sure he's got protection. He's gonna go to an individual route out here for the post pattern against man-to-man. They're gonna pick up the blitz and he's gonna throw a touchdown. And that just shows you the maturity level of this 18-year-old freshman. See the defense, change the play, throw a touchdown.
First down and 10. Play is stuffed. Well, they got 19 yards on that play. They had 21 yards of total offense prior to the play.
And a 45-yard punt return really got him rolling. But this is just excellent work by Eric Ainge, reading, recognizing, and then making the accurate throw to Jason Swain.
Now Mike Shula, as a player, lost in 1985, won here a big victory, 56-28 for Alabama. He was the quarterback in that one in 1986. And obviously a little upset with the results of that last play. Here's Pennington, screen pass, right side. They don't have it set up really well, and it's diagnosed at the 33-yard line. Well, the Aflac, I took
that's
your role.
Right.
I'm sorry, I apologize.
Okay.
Do I get to try it?
Aflac.
Okay. Who started the Alabama-Tennessee victory cigar tradition? Who supplied the cigars? Bear Bryant brought the tradition with him from Texas A&M. Tide trainer Jim Goostrey, who worked for Jenner Leland at Tennessee, became the Bears' personal keeper of the cigars. In 1961, a symbol of Alabama's resurrection under Bear, the cigars were lit after they defeated Tennessee. Here's the pass, contact. Ruled incidental. Jason Allen was there. It will be fourth down.
And a little extra bounce in that Tennessee defense. That possession after their offense got the score. A little jumping around, a little celebrating on the sideline. And Alabama's got to keep their poise right now. They've played well. They are behind with 5 minutes left in the half, but they've got to hold it down now and count on their defense.
Well, because Hefty muffed a punt last week in Ole Miss, they made the change to Derek Tinsley, and whoa, contact is made.
There's no halo rule this year.
No, not at all.
So that was a legal play. A little extra attention paid to Mr. Tinsley right now.
That was Ezekiel Wright, number 84. Now, Philip Fulmer played here, but our Home Depot coach's decision involves his decision to play here. Philip Fulmer out of Winchester, Tennessee, down near the Alabama border, visited Alabama. Bear Bryant tried to convince him to come and be a linebacker, and Tail was told around Knoxville that Bear Bryant was going to retire soon. Fulmer said, okay, I'll come to Knoxville. He did, and he wound up coaching against Bear Bryant.
Yeah, actually committed to Bear Bryant first before changing his mind.
And a timeout is called. In his 13th year as the head coach and a winning percentage of 81, Tennessee leads by four. Very short time.
Mm-hmm.
Pedro Martinez is busy tonight, isn't he? I think he's going to be watching the game up in Fenway Park. Play fake, Ainge. Looks deep. Robert Meacham pulled up, and that one is almost intercepted by Ramsey Robinson.
And, you know, Eric Ainge, I mean, he went for the big play down the field, but he had his fullback wide open. Nobody picked up Corey Anderson coming out of the backfield. He might still be running if Eric Ainge would have thrown him the football. This is a critical drive in the football game right now for Alabama. They've got to hold this thing down. Tennessee got some momentum after the punt return and the touchdown. Joe Kines' defense has played marvelously until they had the short field on that last drive. But they've got to shut it down here.
On second down, Gerald Riggs. Bingo. Daniel Brooks, number 42. And Mark Anderson. Freddie Roach was also there. Anderson led the way, and it's going to be third and eight.
Good to see Jawan Garth back in the ball game for Alabama. He's been out for a couple weeks with a shoulder injury. First week back.
Gerald Riggs, 8 carries for -1. Here's Ainge firing it deep. Tommy Brown, got it?
No, they're calling it incomplete. There was a good hit right at the point of the catch. And Tony Brown, for the second time today, not able to hold on to the football.
Charlie Pepper delivered the blow.
Yeah, you remember he was the guy, Tony Brown, that bobbled the ball that was intercepted by D'Amico Ryans. Now, right at the end of the play, his feet are going to come down and bound, but not able to maintain possession. Good high hit by Pepper.
I'll tell you what impressed me almost as much as the hit, the casualness. Pepper just walked over and sat down.
Yeah.
Took a seat on the bench. It's
just
a punt.
Just doing my job, coach.
Absolutely.
Doing my job.
Out of Plano High School, brother Richard played at Wyoming. We told the story many times in Charlie's career at Alabama. He signed with Dennis Franchione to play at TCU, and then Franchione went to Alabama, so Charlie Pepper followed him. His father, Josh, lives in Ghana. And his grandfather, just to complete the much-told story, was a former president of Ghana who was assassinated in 1979. 4th and 12, and there is a discussion going on here.
I think really some changes in the Alabama secondary this year has really paid off for them. Charlie Pepper was a starting corner last year. They moved him to strong safety with the emergence of Ramsey Robinson. And then they moved Roman Harper from strong safety over to free safety. And you look at the difference last season to this season, a huge jump in pass defense. And the other thing is their nickelback this year, Simeon Castillo, is a young freshman, a very talented guy out of Birmingham. His father was a great defensive back, Jeremiah Castillo at Alabama. And they have played outstanding pass defense this season so far.
Well, apparently there was an official shaken up, but if that is the case, he's fine now. And here is Dustin Colquitt, one of the kicking Colquitts. Father, uncle, he's got a brother who's on the team as a freshman now. And this one is going to be out of bounds and marked there at the 27-yard line. And for more on the kicking Colquitts, let's go to Tracy Wolfson.
You're right, Vern. It is all in the family when it comes to punting here at Tennessee. All-America punter Dustin Colquitt is currently second on the school's punting list with a 43.06 average. That trails only his cousin Jimmy and is just ahead of his father, Craig. And it should stay in the family for years to come. Dustin's brother, Britton, is a freshman at Tennessee. Back to you guys.
All right, Tracy, and you know who the number 4 punter in Tennessee history is? Oh. There's an Affleck question for you.
I don't usually.
To be answered, you know, I know you don't care about these
things.
No, but deserves an answer.
Yeah,
the number
4
career punter is one of the only players to ever play professional football, professional basketball, and be a professional golfer. Huh?
Wow.
Ron Whidbey, old friend from Dallas Cowboy days in the 60s. Played in the ABA. Gotcha, didn't I?
Yeah, you did.
And you don't care, do you?
Well, no, I do, because I'm impressed with your knowledge.
Yeah, it's Trivial Pursuit again. There's the handoff to Castile, and he is wrapped up right away by Omar Gaither, number 44.
And really here in the second half of the second quarter, Tennessee really starting to squeeze this Alabama running game with a little more effectiveness. Alabama ran the ball well in the first quarter. This second quarter, not nearly the same kind of success running against this Tennessee front 7. I think that's where the improvement in this defense over the last 2 weeks for John Chavis has come, in that front 7. They've become much more stout in the last 3 weeks of this season.
3rd and 9. Pennington in the gun. 4-man rush for Tennessee. Pennington goes deep left side, almost intercepted.
He's late.
Yeah.
See, he's late throwing because he's trying to aim it in there. He doesn't want to make a mistake. But when you throw the ball late, it allows fast defensive backs to break on the ball and make plays. You got to throw with a little more anticipation, but when you haven't played a lot and when you're not throwing with a lot of confidence, you tend to hold the ball a little bit too long and wait too late to let it go. And Jason Allen, an easy play for him from his free safety spot.
Second consecutive three and out now, forced by Tennessee. Here's Derek Tinsley, backs up and grabs it at the 14. Heads left, Ezekiel Knight slips, and the flag is down at the 25-yard line. So probably this one's going to go against Tennessee and come back. Wipes out an 18-yard return. Well, this has been a dormant factor for Tennessee in the first six games, and they're getting punt returns now from Tinsley, a former running back.
Yeah, good move by Philip Fulmer, and really something that had been a strength for Alabama coming into the game. They came into the game as the number one team in the conference in net punting, really doing a great job of covering punts. But that 45-yard return by Tinsley cost them the lead in this football game.
The receiving team was holding during the return. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
Sunday on CBS, 40 years ago, a prison escape went wrong. Now the search for a murder victim's true identity unlocks the most surprising cold case ever. Don't miss a new episode Sunday at 8, 7 Central on CBS, America's most watched network.
I've been impressed with the Alabama defense. I was curious because of the competition that they had played coming in. Were those numbers a little inflated? They are playing outstanding football. The one touchdown of Tennessee's was their own defense scored. The last one, the result of the long punt return, defending the short field. But for the most part, they have played very strongly against Tennessee.
Ainge screen pass, Gerald Riggs. Fumble.
I think the ground caused this fumble.
Yeah, that's going to be the rule. Yeah.
Riggs hit the ground and the ball popped up once he hit the ground.
Second down.
Very fortunate though for Gerald Riggs, because that was a touchdown for Alabama. Watch Riggs as he's going down. D'Amico Ryans hits him. He's on the ground and the ball comes out. Yeah, he's down and then the ball pops out. Good call by the officials.
Here's Ainge, drills it, tipped, almost picked off. It was tipped by D'Amico Ryans and Roman Harper down near the shoe tops to try and make the grab.
You know, sometimes you say of a player that he has a nose for the football, a defensive guy. D'Amico Ryans is that kind of a guy. He's got a nose or a hand or a foot for the ball. He knows how to make plays on the football. And two plays in a row, Tennessee very lucky to escape without a turnover.
Brings up a third and seven. Eric Ainge, 5 of 15. And Tennessee, 1 of 5 on third downs thus far. Houston is in the backfield. Draw play. Houston. And Alabama holds. They'll get the ball back. It's D'Amico Ryans again.
I think Alabama will use their last timeout here to stop the clock. Maybe go after the punt. At least stop it and give their offense a chance to get in scoring territory.
Now, time has been called by Alabama. Punt coming up when we return. 87th renewal of this rivalry that has been played in consecutive years since 1928, with the exception of the war year of 1943. Dustin Colquitt on to punt for the fifth time. Looks like, let's see if they come after it. They have blocked two punts this year. They've got the return on. Colquitt straight up and straight down. Very, very short. And this one,
boy, this does not look like the Dustin Colquitt we've seen. He said in the media that he's in a slump. Well, that doesn't look like the Dustin Colquitt that we've become accustomed to watching the last couple years here in Knoxville.
Like many punters, he goes through a pregame ritual. This is Dustin Colquitt visualizing the punt he's going to attempt in the game. I don't think he visualized either the 18-yarder in the first quarter or this one of 27 yards.
I mean, this is so costly, because Alabama, with a minute 10, right in Tennessee territory. A couple plays here, and they're in field goal range.
Pennington, blitz coming. Pennington comes near side. They'll try and get out of bounds and do. It's Keith Brown, number 81, in front of Hefney. Gain of 6 on first down. The Earthlink halftime report coming up. We'll go back to Tim and Spencer in our New York studios. Archie Manning will be there as well.
How ironic was that last week for Archie when Tennessee played Ole Miss down in Oxford? Both the Giants and the Colts had the week off. Eli and Peyton both down there for the game. I talked to Archie this week. He said they just had a great time having both guys there.
There were a few pictures taken.
I bet.
Here's Pennington back. Got him. Flags are down as well. It's Turk McBride. Let's see if this is holding.
Well, it's either going to be holding or face mask.
Right.
No, they're going to call holding.
Well, they might want to decline this, huh?
Yeah, Phillips saying that.
Yeah.
Boy, what a costly sack. Pennington hadn't given up a sack or
holding,
taken a sack until that point.
Number 76 of the offense. Penalty refused. Third down.
Turk McBride working at the tackle position. There's a different right guard in there. That's Travis West, a redshirt freshman in there against Turk McBride, and he got whipped on that play.
Third and 11 with 47 seconds to go. Again, five-man rush. They screen it left side. It's dropped by Kenneth Garvey. And it will be fourth down.
Well, credit to Tennessee defense. Defensive coordinator John Chavis in this second quarter. They gave up 91 yards of offense in the first quarter. If you take a look at their sacks, 10 in the last three games. In that second quarter now, they've only given up under 30 yards of offense. So they did a great job in the second quarter.
Flags down prior to the snap. Or is there a timeout call?
I think Tennessee got a late timeout called. Mike Shula arguing that they didn't get it called
Tennessee,
in time.
They're second of the half.
Alabama tried to kick it quick. They tried to run out and kick it before they could get guys off the field and get a timeout called.
Now there were 14 Tennessee volunteers.
Yeah. And two coaches. I mean, two coaches and 14 players trying to call timeout, and Alabama tried to catch them. But they give Tennessee the timeout.
Nah, that's Shula. He's a shifty one. Time call. Is that a graphic? 42 seconds to go before the break, 14 to 10. Around the SEC, Tommy Tuberville, 10th season as head coach. First time he's ever played Kentucky. Mississippi State defeats Florida 38 to 31. Sylvester Croom's first SEC win. And Arkansas at home tonight against Georgia.
Big question there, the health of Matt Jones. Had the groin injury last week in the game we did.
Now Corey Larkins is back to return the punt, and how about that? They got it down at the 1 yard line.
Wow.
In college play, it's the ball, not the player. And
great
Tyrone Prothro was down there to make the play.
He caught it, and then he threw it back before he went into the end zone. Now
nope.
they're calling it touchback. I thought they would. It still doesn't take anything away from the effort of Prothro. He really, really made a great play on the football. Watch him catch the ball, and then before he goes in, throws it back out. See, the ball crossed
the line.
They never downed it before it crossed. It's okay right there.
Right there, and
not now. They never controlled it before they marked it down. That's a good call, but a great effort by Prothro, nonetheless.
So it comes out to the 20, and Tennessee gets it back. Just a recap for you. On the first Alabama series, a fumble forced by Turk McBride, returned for a touchdown by Paris Harrelson. And then Tennessee came back with a tying touchdown. They took a 10-7 lead. And the punt return just might be the big play of the first half.
Absolutely.
Derek Tinsley.
Two good defenses. Field position is critical. That means your special teams. Alabama doing a great job covering punts coming into the day. But Derek Tinsley, the 45-yard return, gave Eric Gaines the short field. 21-yard touchdown pass to Jason Swain. And that's why Tennessee has a 14-10 lead here at halftime.
Let's go down to Tracy, who's with Philip Fulmer.
Thanks, Vern. Coach, you're up by four, but Alabama's defense doing a good job containing Eric Gaines in your offense. How do you get it going in the second half?
Well, they're the number one defense in the Southeastern Conference for a reason. We just need to make some more plays. We obviously hadn't blocked them very well up front, and we need to make an adjustment or two and see if we can't block them a little better and throw and catch and do those things. Stay on the field. We got to stay on the field.
Could we see Brent Schaefer in the second half?
Perhaps.
Thanks a lot, Coach. Vern, back to you.
All right, thank you, Tracy.
You're on the road, only down by four. Are you happy with what you've seen from your team so far?
Well, I think we played hard. You know, we gave up the first touchdown, which was just a miscommunication. And then, you know, they had the good punt return. That's how they got their second touchdown. But our defense is playing well. You know, we talked about, you know, how important the second half is always in this game. And we got to play better on offense. We got to execute in the passing game better. We're letting some guys up inside make some plays in the running game that we got to hopefully take care of in the second half.
Thanks a lot. Good luck in the second half. Vern, back to you.
Thank you, Tracy. Tennessee won the toss to open this game. They deferred their options, so they will receive the football to start quarter number three. 14-10. Corey Larkins, number 23, is the deep man back. Jamie Christensen will kick off for the Crimson Tide. Fourteen-10. Here's Larkins. And we are set to go. 87th meeting between these two. Boomed it.
Boy.
Oh. Yeah. Somebody check the helium supply. That was really a terrific kick by Jamie Christensen. And a first down. I think I'm as impressed with this Alabama defense. Yeah. As anything in the first half.
Well, they've been impressive. Tennessee's defense was impressive, particularly in the second quarter. I think the second half is very simple now. Alabama can't win the game if they aren't more productive throwing the football, only 61 yards passing. Tennessee, I don't think they'll win the game if they don't run the ball better, only 9 yards rushing on 12 attempts in that first half. That's what it's going to come down to, which team does what they need to do in the second half.
On first down, the handoff goes to Gerald Riggs, who has had a non-productive afternoon. Jeremy Clark is there to make the tackle. Halftime stats presented by the Hartford. First downs, minimal number. Rushing yards, very minimal for Tennessee. It's been a defensively dominated game.
Well, Alabama did everything they needed to do in terms of possessing the football, gaining more yards. The one breakdown in special teams is the difference in this game on the scoreboard so far.
Now the touchdown specialist, short yardage specialist, Jabari Davis, is on this second down and 10. Here's Ainge. Fires it for Tony Brown. He's got the grab at the 36-yard line. The senior co-captain. A gain of 16, a first down. Well, this Tennessee team, it's kind of skewed when you look at the points per game against opponents. That's because of that huge loss to Auburn.
Right. And they got waxed pretty good up here by Auburn, but in the other SEC games, close, but they found ways to win. And that's all that matters, really.
Here's Ainge, first down and 10.
Well, they say on the golf scorecard, you don't have to draw a picture, just put the number in there, right?
Yeah, right.
Doesn't matter how you got it.
There's a Jabari Davis gets the carry and comes left. Well, first half possessions for Tennessee. You see Dustin Colquitt very active as a punter and not that effective.
And you see the big difference that was highlighted where they started with the football after that punt return at the Alabama 29. That made all the difference for a Tennessee offense that only gained 53 yards in the whole first half.
Second down and 8. Davis still in as the tailback. And here's Ainge with time. Man coverage right side. Man open right side. Catch is made by Jason Swain.
Great catch by Swain.
Over Ramsey Robinson.
Now some of these receivers for Tennessee are really tall. Jason Swain is 6'1", but he's 210 pounds. He's a strong receiver. Does a nice job of just keeping the defender off of his body and making the hands with his catch. Or making the catch with his hands. You know what I meant. Great job of catching the football with his hands against close coverage.
Gain of 37, first down at the 25-yard line.
And that's the first big play that the Alabama defense has given up.
Talked about this average. Excuse me, I'm sorry, Todd. Hand off to Davis. Oh, he is popped. Freddie Roach, number 8.
Yeah. Freddie Roach, great penetration, just blew up the block of Corey Anderson, the fullback, who was trying to block him and knocked Davis down right at the line of scrimmage. Freddie Roach is a guy who a month ago Joe Kind sat him down and said, you're not playing well enough for us. And you know, kind of had a heart-to-heart with him, and he has really played well in the last four ball games.
One of a quartet of players that Joe Kind's singled out to us in our conversation on Wednesday as being real leaders on this team. D'Amico Ryan's another. And here is the handoff. It's Davis.
Boy, they just cannot get anything. They can't gain a yard running the football today. They're trying three different backs. They're trying to go with a bigger, stronger back. And you know what? They didn't run the ball well at all against Ole Miss last week either. You know, Ole Miss had some, created some problems for them with their quickness and stunts. Alabama's defensive front holding their own and just nowhere to run for the Tennessee backs.
Third and eight, three wideouts in. Here's the change by Ainge again. He looks out at Chris Hannon on the right side wearing number 13. He's got Tony Brown and Brett Smith to the near side. Out of the eye, they go right side. Oh, very my close. Goodness.
Roman Harper was reading that the entire way. I mean, he was alert to the check. He was reading Eric Ainge's eyes, and he made a break on the ball and almost came up with the interception. Ainge is only looking to the corner. He's not looking at Roman Harper, the safety, who read his eyes and came up to make the play.
That's going to bring on James Wilhoit for a 40-yard field goal attempt. Wilhoit had one of the biggest field goals of this season, a 51-yarder to defeat Florida our first game on September 18th, but you can see by the numbers he's not having a great year. This is from 40 yards out. It cuts just inside, then looked like Kurt Schilling. Had a lot of movement. It's good. Will Hoyt hits from 40. Philip Fulmer's team up by 7. 17-10 early third quarter. 17-10, 11:32 to go. Tennessee increases the lead. They're about to kick off.
Yeah, and I saw them working on a couple different kinds of kickoffs in practice on Thursday, partly because of the dangerous return men that Alabama have had this year. One of them is an onside kick, intentional, where you're thinking that they're going to run back to set up the return. The other one is a bloop kick that you try to hit right around the 20-yard line. I wouldn't be surprised to see some kind of an unusual kick here by James Wilhoit after they up their lead by three more points.
Brandon Brooks broke over the deep man, and this is a conventional kick.
Short though.
Yes, it is at the 9-yard line, taken by Brandon Brooks. He's listed at 5'5" and 160 pounds. Jabari Davis makes the tackle. Let's go down to Tracy Wolfson for the SEC Moment presented by Sonic.
Today's moment is all about Victory Cigars. In 1961, the Crimson Tide, rolling to its first national title under Bear Bryant, defeated Tennessee for the first time since the Bears' arrival at Alabama. Trainer Jim Goostrey broke out the cigars, a tradition every winning Tide team has enjoyed since. In 95, Tennessee ended a 9-game winless streak in the series, giving Philip Fulmer his first victory over Alabama as a head coach, as the Vols broke out their own cigars in celebration.
Right, Tracy. Well, this was in 1995. To a person, the coaching staff mentions that 95 victory is the most memorable in this series for them. And this is Philip Fulmer's 30th year. Randy Sanders, the offensive coordinator, his 20th Alabama game. John Chavis, the defensive coordinator, his 19th. Second down. Kenneth Darby back in.
Spencer Pennington hit 4 of 7 to start the game, and then only 3 of his next 10 passes, and none down the field for big yards.
Darby.
Nice run.
Breaks a tackle.
Wow. Great effort by Darby.
Yes, it was. And there's a second down effort that gets him out to the 36-yard line. Rashawn Fellows and Paris Harrelson make the tackle.
Running yards a little harder to come by ever since that first quarter for Ken Darby, but he does a nice job of breaking some tackles, being patient, and not giving up on the play. And as it turns out, a 3rd and short, which could have been about a 3rd and 6 if he didn't keep fighting for that one.
Darby's second start for the day, 59 yards. Now Castile and LaRon McClain behind Spencer Pennington on 3rd and 1. It'll be Castile. Oh, boy.
I think his forward progress got it.
Omar Gaither up around the neck to make the tackle, and Kevin Burnett with help. See about the spot.
It was a very high tackle, and that's why he didn't get to fall forward for any yards. Five-man defensive line for Tennessee. Good push. And the high tackle, that stopped him right at the point. Bring the chains in.
Ouch. Gaither is playing terrific football for Tennessee.
Yeah,
number 44.
Really is.
Up short.
Wow. Fourth and very short. First possession of the second half. Mike Shula going to punt the football. And you know what? It's probably a smart decision here. The way his defense has played, don't put your defense in a bad situation. You've already done that twice in the ball game so far.
Well, thinking about Dave Rader, the offensive coordinator, who said to us on Wednesday, there is nothing wrong with a punt.
Yeah, punting's not a bad thing, especially if you play defense the way that we're playing defense so far this year.
Dave Rader, who was for a long time the head coach at Tulsa, and was also the offensive coordinator when Mike Shula was a quarterback at Alabama.
Ray Perkins was the head coach at that time. Mike just still upset they didn't get that third and one.
Here's Freeland, and a nice punt. Fair catch is called for and taken by Jonathan Hefney, number 33.
See, that's okay. I mean, that's a great punt by Freeland. You put your defense on the field, and Tennessee is 80-plus yards away from the end zone. That's sound, smart, conservative football for Alabama.
Back at Neyland, where at the half, Tennessee led by a 14-0, 14-10 count. And at that point, they had 53 total yards. Their opening drive of the third quarter, they went 57 and got a field goal. Here's play action. Eric Ainge being chased. Pulls up, fires it. Big play. That's caught by C.J. Faton, number 17. A gain of 20 on the first down and 10. Faton, who caught the fourth and 19 pass in last year's overtime win for Tennessee against Alabama.
Little bootleg for Ainge, showing his mobility to get out of the pocket. Another tough throw back across his body, but that time very accurate to crossing Faton.
First down and 10 on the 20-yard gain. Ainge with the change. Backs come up, make sure they've got it. Now they're back. Hand off. Houston. To the 50.
Best run of the day for Tennessee right there.
Gain of 13, another first down.
A checkoff at the line of scrimmage, running the power play weak. Aaron Sears pulling through, the fullback with a nice block. And the best run by far of the day for the Tennessee offense.
Houston, who was the starter for the first five games of the year, and gave way to Gerald Briggs last week.
Another call from the line of scrimmage. Randy Sanders giving the call in. After they see what the Alabama defense is lined up in. Alabama not changing anything. They're lining up and playing the defense right here.
There's Houston again to the right side. Well, after that pass completion to C.J. Faton, this was Eric Ainge and...
It's Rudy. Rudy Griffin and Eric Ainge. A couple soon-to-be folk heroes in their respective states.
Rudy, who started his career at the Citadel, and Eric Ainge, who did not grow up knowing a lot about this rivalry out in Portland, Oregon. Hillsboro, to be precise, a suburb of Portland in the Northwest.
Little difference in Alabama. They're not moving around as much on defense. They got burned a couple times by moving and showing something too early. Little different look now.
Hand off. Houston down at the 45-yard line. Well, let's go down to Tracy for more on Eric Ainge and his growing up in the Pacific Northwest.
A funny thing, guys, before coming to Tennessee, Eric Ainge actually donned the crimson and white. He even chanted Roll Tide a few times. That's because Ainge's high school, Glencoe, is nicknamed the Crimson Tide. Now, is that ironic or what?
What are the odds?
Very strange.
Oh, dear. Third and six.
I wonder how that happened. Do you think the principal was a Bear Bryant fan at some point or what?
Maybe
the Crimson
so.
Tide. That's bizarre.
Yeah, it kind of is. Here's Ainge, pulls up, drills it too high, almost intercepted. Flag is down. Oh, Anthony Madison was called for interference in the first half.
And then another late flag after that.
That's Simeon Castile, number three.
This pass was very high. And the call is going to go against Ramsey Robinson, but that pass was high and probably would have been very difficult to catch. Eric Ainge stepped up in the pocket, moved around a little bit.
Pass interference, number 17 of the defense. Penalty is first down at the spot of the foul.
Costly penalty against Alabama. Watch again, Ainge stepped up in the pocket. A little bit of contact, but boy, I don't know if that warrants a pass interference or not. Again, probably a pass that Brett Smith would have had a difficult time making the catch on.
Cedric Houston back in the backfield as Riggs is getting a rest, ineffective in the first half. Here's Houston, and he's ineffective on that play as Chris Harris, number 91, is there to make the tackle. The sophomore from Tuscaloosa.
Right now, Alabama, their defense needs to come up with a play, a sack, a turnover, something, because they're not able to get much pressure on Eric Ainge. They've stopped the run, other than that one 13-yarder by Cedric Houston, but they've not been able to put any pressure on Eric Ainge, and he's been able to hit some throws on him.
Second down, 10, 17-0, and timeout is called.
Alabama had to use a timeout there. Joe Kynes wanted to make sure they had the right defensive personnel and call.
Time call with 6:22 to go, third quarter. It's 17-10, Tennessee. Alabama and Tennessee played for the first time in 1901, a 6-6 tie in Birmingham. This one is 17-10 as we play midway through the third quarter. A crowd of 107,017 have packed inside Neyland Stadium, the 87th meeting between these two. 17-10, this is the sixth play of the drive. Gerald Riggs back in. Here's the freshman, Eric Ainge. Finds a receiver at the 22-yard line. That's Jason Swain, who has a touchdown catch on a 19-yarder back in the first quarter.
Well, this has to be a game that Jason Swain gets up for a little more than others. As you mentioned, from Grissom High School at Huntsville, Alabama. He's got some friends on this other team, guys he knew from high school. But this is one where they probably didn't talk much this week. Probably talk after the game, but not before the game.
Well, he and Darby are good friends. Here's the first down, Kenneth Darby, the running back. And that's a first down play to the 22-yard line. Let's go back and spend a moment with Tim Brando in New York.
Well, we were telling you guys, Vern, about at halftime about Florida State struggles against Wake Forest. Well, it was all set up with Willie Reed, a 49-yard punt return. He caps it off by taking this 20-yard touchdown toss from Wyatt Sexton. 14-10, Demon Deacons in the third.
All right, Tim, thank you. 17-10 here on the handoff. Here goes Riggs. There is a flag as Riggs is tackled at the 9-yard line by Roman Harper and Anthony Madison.
What a tough penalty. It's going to go on Chris Hannon, I think, the wide receiver, blocking downfield, number 13. But again, Tennessee has figured a few things out in this second half against this Alabama defense. Again, only 53 yards of offense in the first half. Two pretty impressive offensive drives here.
Remember what Philip Fulmer told Tracy Wolfson at the break? We've got to adjust our blocking, the way we're blocking these plays.
On the offense during the run, 10-yard penalty.
That's wiped out.
Well, I think one of the things they're doing is they're running to the left a little more behind Munoz and Rob Smith. Here's where the penalty is going to occur out here. Chris Hannon blocking on Anthony Madison, and he got a hold of the jersey. And it wipes out an outstanding run to the weak side by Tennessee. Again, they're not going to the right side as much here in the second half, going behind Munoz and Rob Smith, the left guard.
That is a 12-yard run followed by a 10-yard penalty from the spot, and it results in a second down and 5 at the 20-yard line. Gerald Riggs is the running back. The handoff comes left, cuts back, Aaron Sears was up there providing blocking help, and Roman Harper makes the tackle. Now, Gerald Riggs, his dad was a three-time Pro Bowler, Atlanta and Washington. I saw Papa Riggs on a sports talk television show last night.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, he was opining about the baseball playoffs with Jamie Dukes, the old Atlanta Falcon guard.
Mm-hmm.
Fun to watch him. Third and two at the 17. That was while you were having your victory cigar last night. Third and two. Anderson is the fullback. Ainge right side, Jason Swain. Oh, he did a nice job of avoiding the tackle just long enough to pick up a first down. Robinson and Pepra were there. Jason Swain, nifty, nifty run.
A little bit of off coverage by Robinson. Nice throw by Ainge, and then Swain, after he probably went behind the first down, used his strength to get past it again for the first down. You know, big game for Jason Swain so far today.
Hand off to Gerald Riggs going right. And down at the 6-yard line. Cornelius Wortham, number 16, made the tackle.
Philip Fulmer has to be real pleased with what his offensive line is doing here in the second half. I mean, they did not run worth a lick in the first half. Being an old offensive lineman and line coach, they probably got after him a little bit in that locker room and said, hey, we have got to run the football to win this game. We can't go three and out. We can't not control the football.
Here's Riggs on second down. He gets inside the 5. To the 4, Rudy Griffin, number 90, makes the tackle, and Ramsey Robinson was there to help as well. Gerald Riggs spent time as a young man in Nevada, then back in Atlanta where his dad was playing, moved to Chattanooga. High school career at Chattanooga, storied in this state, 6,000 yards, 90 touchdowns. Now Cedric Houston is in on third down. Third and one.
Another change from the line of scrimmage. Randy Sanders calling in a new check on third down and one.
Play clock, they just do beat it. Here's Ainge under pressure. Tip intercepted. What a play by Cornelius Wortham. Oh, boy. Tipped it and grabbed it. And the look of disappointment on the faces of Doug and Diane Ainge.
Well, part of the problem is the play clock was right down around one. Here's Wortham right here. They're trying to throw quick slants, and Wortham is just going to read the quarterback. He's going to drop in the area. Actually came from the middle linebacker spot and got a hand on the football, watching the quarterback the whole way from the blind spot. Pressure applied by Todd Bates. Alabama dodges one there.
6.5 minutes and 78 yards on the drive. Now Pennington, play fake from the end zone. It's caught, but only 3 yards are gained as Castile is knocked down by Jason Allen. Let's take another look at that interception.
Well, we'll watch Philip Fulmer as he watched the interception. Oh, boy. The reason that was so important is this keeps it a one-score game for Alabama. It's still 17-10. Both defenses playing well in the ball game, and Alabama still down by one score, but deep in their own territory.
Two turnovers today, both interceptions. Here's Pennington back. Left side drills this one.
Big completion right
there. Yes, it is. Out to the 20-yard line. Tyrone Prothrow, number 4. That's a gain of 15.
And again, I get back to the point about Alabama. If they want to have a chance to win this game, they have to have more production from Spencer Pennington in the passing game. This is a good, solid throw. He didn't hesitate. He didn't wait. He didn't hold it too long. He stepped back and threw the football. They're going to get shots to throw it. Tennessee still very conscious of stopping the Alabama running game. There are opportunities to throw it downfield, and he's got to hit some here in the second half.
Pennington now 9 of 19 for 79. Alabama has not passed for more than 100 yards in a game since Brody Croyle's injury. Here is Darby breaking a tackle.
Boy, what a run.
Fights outside the 30.
You know, when they talk about the box, you hear guys talking about putting 8 defenders in the box and 9 defenders in the box. And most defenses that want to stop the run, they want to put one more defender in the box than you can block. And that means the tailback has to beat one defender. See, Alabama can block 7, but they can't block 8. So Ken Darby has to take care of the 8th one. There's the 8th guy, Parrish, who came in unblocked. And Darby able to make guys miss in tight spaces for extra yardage.
Gain of 11 for Darby. First down and 10 at the 31-yard line. Here's the option play. Pennington pulls back. Nobody open as Prothero was down blocking. And it's an incomplete pass on a broken route, I believe.
And they had linemen downfield because this was not supposed to be a pass. And I think that's what's going to be the call against Alabama. This was supposed to be an option or a run, not a pass. And there were Alabama linemen running down the field.
Steve Landis is going to confer with one more official. Come over to the side.
We've had a lot of conferences in this game, haven't
we? Yes, we have. Uh-huh. More so than normal. Having duly deliberated, that's the call.
See, if it would have been a screen pass or something behind the line of scrimmage, it would have been okay because you can release linemen down the field. But watch as this play comes down the line. It looks like an option that was too well defended by Tennessee to run. There's the fake. There's two guys out there, and Spencer Pennington pulls up, and look, there's linemen all the way down here. So not a very well-conceived or executed play that time by Alabama.
And the 5-yard penalty leaves Mike Shula's bunch with a 1st and 15. Interception by Wortham at the 2-yard line. They've moved it out this far. They trail by 7. Darby.
Look at that. Again, if we can look at this from behind Ken Darby, I mean, this. The thing that he does is he has the ability to stop and change direction and make unblocked guys miss him. See, right there, there's a guy that he makes miss, Jonathan Hefney, who there was nobody to block him, but Ken Darby beats him by just making a move, planting his right foot, cutting inside, and adding 5 yards to the run. That's just good inside running, making people miss.
79 yards for the day. He had 197 last week in Tuscaloosa in the victory over Southern Miss. 2nd and 6. He got 9 on the last one. Here's a play fake. Pennington rolling right, pulls it up, fires it incomplete.
Out of bounds.
Yep. Matt Cadell, number 11. That gives Mike Shula a chance to chat with Spencer Pennington. At one point, he didn't think he was going to get an offer to come to Tuscaloosa. He had verbally accepted at Mississippi State. And then he was telling us about his team preparing for the state 4A high school playoffs. Dennis Franchione was there, offered him a chance to come to Alabama, and he excitedly took that offer. He's nailed. The catch is made by Knight. Ezekiel Knight at the 40, but it's a yard short. And Kevin Burnett nailed Knight, or nailed Pennington, rather.
Both clean hits, both serious hits. One on the quarterback, one on the receiver, and Alabama's got to punt the football. Kevin Burnett packs a wallop now. He's 6'3", 235 pounds, caught him right up in the midsection. And then after the catch, Ezekiel Knight leveled by Jason Allen, the free safety. Two clean hits, and Alabama's got a punt.
I think back to when Kevin Burnett welcomed us back out of commercial, and he looked at the camera and said, "Boo."
Here's the hit again. Got air on the blitz. Clean hit.
And there's a flag and another conference.
Might have been a sideline warning on Tennessee. I think they were overly excited there.
I believe that's it. Mm-hmm. Kevin Burnett, in anticipation of Halloween. That's the end of the third quarter with our score 17-10, Tennessee. We'll return to Neyland Stadium right after these messages. Well, we begin the fourth quarter with a reprise of Kevin Burnett's appearance. You make a hit like that, and this becomes like a late-night television commercial. The greatest hits of Kevin Burnett. And here's Freeland's punt. Corey Larkins is back instead of Derek Tinsley. And I'm reminded of what Dave Rader said. There's nothing wrong with a punt. We begin quarter number four. Freeland with a nice effort, and that pins Tennessee back. And time has been called. Tennessee leads it 17-10. Here's one of the mascots. As we get ready, here's the real one, Smokey. And Tennessee with a first down at the 11-yard line. First down and 10. And off, up the middle. And out to the 16-yard line. That the second play of the fourth quarter in a bitterly contested game as these two teams meet for the 87th time. And a 7-point difference. I think you like what Tennessee accomplished in the third quarter.
Yeah, I really do. I think they seized the momentum of the game, and I think it started with their offensive line. They made some adjustments at halftime. Only 53 yards of offense in the whole first half. They more than doubled that in the third quarter. 126 yards of offense, and they found some ways to run the football against this Alabama defense.
And a second down and four after that 6-yard gain on first down. Riggs remains as the deep back in the eye and gets the handoff this time. Nothing going on as Anthony Bryant makes the tackle. Let's go back to the studio for this Pontiac game-changing performance.
Quality karma in New England. Although the Boston area teams are doing well. Paul Peterson of BC hits Tony Gonzalez a 30-yard touchdown pass with under a minute remaining in the fourth, capping an 8-play, 74-yard drive. For the fourth straight time, BC beats Notre Dame.
Wow. Okay, Tim, thank you. Notre Dame gets a bye next week. Yeah.
Some teams just play great against certain teams. That's the way it is with Boston College and Notre Dame. They just get up for that game and just play extremely well against him.
Third and four on the ground out to the 20. That'll be short of the first down, and the Volunteers will have to punt. Yeah,
big stop by the Alabama defense there. They should get decent field position after this punt by Colquitt.
They have been impressive on defense.
Yep.
Well, there goes a homecoming for Saj. Fourth and one, and Colquitt has had his problems today. One of 18 and one of 27. Brandon Brooks, all 5'5" of him, waiting for it at the 32-yard line. This one's short. Bounces, though, and gets a Tennessee roll. Inside the 35, down at the 34-yard line, a 47-yard punt for Dustin Colquitt. Early in the fourth quarter at Neyland Stadium in this bitter rivalry, a 7-point ball game.
Now, it's time for the block of the day, presented by Earthlink.
On Alabama's touchdown, watch the three blocks by the tight end, the fullback, and the backside guard. Perfect execution on the touchdown run that opens it up for Tim Castile to score. First, the tight end, Clint Johnston, is going to block down. Danny March is going to pull around and lead through, and the fullback, LaRon McClain, a crushing block on the edge. Alabama only scored once, but it sure was pretty. The Earthlink block of the day.
For more on Earthlink's block of the day, log on to cbssportsline.com/earthlink.
Welcome back to Knoxville, Tennessee, up 17-10. We were wondering earlier why wide receiver Derek Tinsley of Tennessee was not in the game. He suffered a mild concussion in the second quarter. He will be back in on punt coverage and offense only. He will not return punts. Vern?
Okay, thank you, Tracy. First down and 10, Alabama, trailing by 7. Spencer Pennington will throw. Good protection this time across the middle. That one's caught by Castile, and he breaks a tackle and then is rudely brought down at the 43-yard line.
Yeah, that's a little bit different, hitting Tim Castile coming across the middle as opposed to Ezekiel Knight on that last third down play. You bounce off of a 230-pound fullback a little more than you do a tall, skinny wide receiver. Jason Allen, who's had a couple big hits, is going to be the guy that hits Castile after the catch. As you mentioned, great protection. Allowed Pennington to stay in there. There's one missed tackle by a linebacker, and then Jason Allen finally gets the tackle.
That was Johnny Poe, yeah. John Poe, number 56. And I'll bring the chain out to see if he got enough for the first down. It would appear, yes.
It was an important first down play for Alabama because four of Alabama's last five possessions have resulted in three and outs. And you don't want your defense to be tired here in the fourth quarter. You want to give them as much help as you can. You've got field position. Move the football. Let your defense rest a little bit. It's still a one-score game. You can't afford three and outs at this point in the game.
Second half, averaging 7 yards on each first down. Here's a reverse. Keith Brown going right, gets a terrific block from Evan Mathis and flies down the sidelines. They might call holding.
I don't think that's a flag. I think it's a shoe.
Okay.
It looks like a flag, but I think it's a shoe. An orange shoe. Because that was a good block by Evan Mathis on Turk McBride. He could have very easily turned that into a hold, but he didn't. The key is keeping your hands inside. Watch Evan Mathis, 51, lead out here on the reverse by Keith Brown. Very well executed, and as Mathis pulls out, he gets Turk McBride, and he keeps his hands inside. He doesn't hold, and that enables Keith Brown to get to the corner and turn in a good play.
Rashawn Fellows is the fellow who is shoeless. 17-yard gain, first down at the 39. Here's Pennington, play fake. Across the middle, too high for Tyrone Prothro. A little too much zip on that one.
A little bit of adrenaline on that one by Spencer.
And let's go back and spend a moment with Tim Brando in New York.
All right, fellas, Missouri had the edge. It was 17-7 at half against Oklahoma State. Donovan Woods calling his own number here. And that ties the game at Faurot Field. Remember, Oklahoma State's got Oklahoma coming up. Right now, they still have to deal with the Tigers. Back to Vern.
All right, Tim, thank you. 17-10 here, second down and 10 at the 39 of Alabama. Spencer Pennington, 11 of 23. This team yet to throw for more than 100 yards in a game under either Pennington or Gillen. Here's Darby, cuts it nicely and spins. What a terrific run. Oh, boy, that was something.
It really is. I mean, he is a fun guy to watch run the football because he just doesn't stop on the play. When it looks like he's going to be down, he keeps twisting and churning and churning. And if you don't wrap him up and get him on the ground, he's going to keep gaining yards. Low center of gravity, good balance, and good strength.
Third and one. At the 30. In the eye with two tight ends.
Five defensive linemen again for Tennessee.
Two fullbacks. Castile's the deep man. He gets the ball. And he's got a first down on second effort as he thwarts the tackle of Omar Gaither.
And see, that play, that is what this rivalry is about to me. Intensity, hard-hitting physical football. Third and one. Tennessee expects run. Alabama says, you know what? We are running. Stop it. And it just is, it's just a battle of wills on a play like that. Third and one, five defensive linemen for Tennessee, two tight ends and a big tailback for Alabama, and a first down for the Crimson Tide.
First down and 10 at the 28 with 10:20 to go. And again, they stay with the same two backs, McClain and Castile. It's play fake. Pennington, Prothro, looks for a block, gets a little bit of help. As Wesley Britt was out there, but too many guys clad in orange converged, a gain of 7. Well, Tennessee, of course, had that big wing at Georgia, then one at Ole Miss. They're 3-1 in conference. If they win, they continue to control their fate. And out west, Auburn winning again today. Alabama, LSU, Ole Miss, Arkansas all with two defeats. But Alabama is bowl eligible this year. If they get six wins, they're going to be going to a bowl. Second down, backs in the eye. They hand it to McClain, and that one didn't work.
Mm-mm. John Poe is in there at middle linebacker, partly because he is probably the most physical linebacker outside of Kevin Burnett that they have. Jason Mitchell has been playing the middle linebacker ever since Kevin Simon was injured in that Florida game. But John Poe, at 235 pounds and 5'11", is a very physical middle linebacker. And that's why he's in there in these situations against this Alabama offense.
9 minutes to go on the road, 107,000 watching, roaring. It's third and three. Darby back in as the tailback. It's Darby with a handoff. Gets a terrific block and cuts down to the 18.
That was a great block. Was that Danny Martz leading the play again?
Yes, it was.
Boy, he's done a nice job. They love to pull the backside guard, lead with the fullback and pull the backside guard. Watch Martz come and the fullback on this play and just open it up. Fullback kicks out the end. Danny Martz kicks out the legs of the safety. And Darby gets the first down. They really like running that play. LaRon McClain with a nice block. Power football. I mean, you know, Tennessee knows it's coming, but they're executing it and still picking up to the yard they need.
92 yards for Darby, first down. That's McClain, the fullback. Pennington, modest play fake. He's in trouble.
No, you can't take a sack.
And he fumbled. And it is recovered by Alabama, but oh dear.
And if you see Mike Shula on the sideline, he's saying, throw it away. You got to throw this away if you're Spencer Pennington. You've got a great drive going. You've got momentum. You're trying to throw the post, but it's double covered. If it's not there, you have to throw the football away. The worst possible thing you can do here is take the sack. Jesse Mahalona playing with a bum knee. You just have to do it. I mean, you just can't put your team, after you've moved the football and you've been ahead of the chains, now you're way behind the chains, second and a mile.
Specifically, 25. That was a loss of 15. Tennessee brings a man on the corner. Darby tries to bounce outside. He fights to the 30-yard line. It'll be third down.
See, the other thing that that play did was it took you out of pretty sure field goal range into testy field goal range now for Brian Boston. His long for the season, 45 yards. He's one of three between 40 and 49 yards. So that sack was huge.
And it's third and 22. Ezekiel Knight back in the lineup, number 84, joined there by Keith Brown, DJ Hall, and Prothro. So four wide from the 30. Third and 22.
And all Pennington's got to be thinking here is get a little bit closer for the field goal. Don't think you have to get the first down.
Corner blitz. Pennington under pressure. One option. Paris Harrelson with the pressure.
Third down and 22. You know it's passed. So they're just going to rush the three. They're going to drop eight. They do bring a fourth guy, Jason Allen, late, but seven guys dropping into zone coverage. Nobody there to throw the football to. DJ Hall in the middle. Thought he was open, but Pennington not able to make the throw.
And Spencer Pennington took the sack. Couldn't find a receiver. Bostic from 47. This would be a season long if it's good. Got plenty of distance. He got it. That cuts the lead to four. Brian Bostic, who in that five overtime thriller a year ago had one blocked from 26 and missed from 45, makes a bit of a memory for himself tonight with a 47-yard field goal. But the big play was the sack by Jesse Mahalona playing on a badly sprained knee. 6:26 to go in the fourth, a 47-yard Brian Bostic field goal. Shaves the margin to four. Tennessee leads it 17-13 as Jamie Christensen gets set to kick off for the Crimson Tide. Corey Larkins is the deep man. Wearing number 23, he awaits it at the goal line. Another boomer. Boy, he's an effective weapon.
Yeah.
That comes out to the 20. Now this week's Scholar Athlete presented by Red Lobster. Rob Smith, the sophomore, GPA of 3.49. He's a major in criminal justice, 2003 academic All-SEC. Red Lobster's commitment to the investment of our future is shown today by donating $1,000 to Tennessee's General Scholarship Fund. Remember what Randy Sanders said about him yesterday?
That was great.
He said he gets stuff all over. He plays. He said you want to pat him on the back, but you don't want to hug him.
Yeah, not sure what you'd come away with.
He's having a wonderful season in 2004. Tony Brown in motion. 17-13, ball at the 20. They hand it off to Riggs. That's one. D'Amico Ryans with the tackle. And let's go back and check in once again with him in New York.
All right, Vern. Garrett Rivas of Michigan has a 32-yard field goal attempt blocked by Purdue's Bobby Iwechukwu. Now, the Boilermakers cling to a one-point lead. And remember, Wisconsin is 5-0 in the conference, Michigan 4-0. So more than a passing interest from the Badgers right now in that game.
Indeed. Nice pronunciation there, Tim. Third down.
Third and long, two running plays for nothing for Tennessee. Now, Tennessee has run for 56 yards here before those two plays, compared to only 9 in the first half. Very important in order for them to hold on here to run the football, because running it eats up clock. Now third and 10. Eric Gaines may have to put it up in the air.
Swain is the deep man, widest to the left. And Eric Gaines out of the gun. Officially third and 9 from the 21. And they hand it off in the draw play. Stuffed at the 25-yard line. Freddie Roach, and this crowd is responding to the conservative nature of the call by Randy Sanders.
Well, I think part of that is out of respect for the Alabama defense and their ability to force turnovers. 17 turnovers forced coming into the game. You've got a freshman quarterback. Alabama has to score a touchdown. A field goal doesn't do them any good. So you punt the football, you let the clock run, and you hope your defense can come up with another stop.
Dustin Colquitt to punt for the 7th time, averaging just under 40 in this game.
What they're saying is, rather than let the Alabama defense beat us, we want to make Spencer Pennington beat us. That's the odds that they're playing right now with that kind of call.
Here's the snap, return is on. And Brandon Brooks comes up, does not get a chance to catch it. That's Chris Hannon who lets it roll to the 28-yard line. 47-yard punt, nothing on the return. Alabama with Spencer Pennington at the controls. They have the ball and they trail by 4. Neyland Stadium in Knoxville, 4:21 to go, 17-13 Tennessee. Let's check the CBS Sportsline stat of the game. Total yards, 111 for Alabama since the first quarter, but 201 for Tennessee. Get complete game stats at CBSSportsline.com. As a boy growing up in Fayette, Alabama, I can only imagine that Spencer Pennington fantasized about this moment. A chance to lead the Crimson Tide to a come-from-behind victory at Tennessee. Well, he gets the first down pass complete to Tyrone Prothrow.
And at this point, you take any of those that you can get. I mean, they're going to play off, and you can throw the hitch, throw it. His 13th completion on the day in 26 attempts. He's been sacked twice. See that, all career highs for him. He's over the 100-yard mark, but only one pass play of 20 yards or more. He's going to have to hit another one to put his team in a chance to win.
Draw play. Darby nailed.
Kevin Burnett. Jesse Mahalona stuffed the play. He got the penetration. Burnett gets the tackle. But Jesse Mahalona, playing with the bad knee, still giving his team a boost. I really think the last couple weeks he has played outstanding football. Gets the push, forces Darby to move behind the line of scrimmage, and then Burnett able to finish him off.
Playing on that bum left knee, Mahalona from Kailua Kona, Hawaii. junior college transfer, first year in Knoxville. Second down. They'll give it to Darby. He comes left, and he runs into Jason Allen at the 49-yard line. It'll be third and short. That's a gain of 10.
Clock
so now, 3 minutes.
Yeah, working against Alabama because, again, a field goal doesn't do them any good. They have to have a touchdown. They're down four. So they're not thinking about just trying to get in Brian Bostic's range here. They've got to get it all the way to the checkerboard. Two timeouts remaining. And I think Spencer Pennington needs to get a little more sense of urgency about what he's doing here. Because, again, they need to conserve as much time as they can. They're not into a hurry-up offense yet, but they need to speed up their tempo.
J.B. Klausner is the center on third and three. They'll keep it on the ground, and there is a fine defensive play by Omar Gaither. Fourth down.
Penetration again. He came on a blitz from the outside. He timed it perfectly. Here's Gaither right here. Watch him time it. Hits us on the run, and nobody can pick him up. They tried to bring Evan Mathis, the guard, out, but Gaither was already across the line of scrimmage before Mathis could get to him. What a big, big play for Tennessee on third down.
Here's the ball game, fourth and six. Three wide receivers wide right, one is left from the spread. It'll be a five-man rush for Tennessee. Pennington goes for pro throw, and he was open by 3 yards.
There's going to be a roughing the passer, though. There's going to be a roughing the passer on Tennessee at the end of this play. Of all the penalties at that point, none could be worse for the Volunteers.
Here's Steve Landis.
Personal foul, roughing the passer, number 98.
Paris Harrelson has been playing outstanding football, but a shot to the head, a good call by the officials. You can't hit him in the face. They got the incompletion. They would have had the ball and gone into the victory formation. As it is, Alabama with new life and a new set of downs. Wow.
Alabama has two timeouts remaining, 96 seconds to go in regulation. These two teams a year ago, 17-17 at the end of regulation, they went five overtimes. This one doesn't seem destined for overtime. This is all or nothing for Alabama on this drive. Play fake, screen pass, left side, Castile. Another great defensive play, this one by Jonathan Heffney.
And Tim Castile is hurt. I mean, he got his legs cut out from under him, and he probably took a helmet right on the thigh on this play by Heffney. Well defended, diagnosed by Heffney, read the screen, got inside the block, and cut down Tim Castile.
And the clock continues to run.
Yeah, and no sense of urgency by Alabama. They need a touchdown, not a field goal. Wasting too much time.
Pennington back, good blitz pickup, goes deep, it's intercepted. Picked off by Tennessee, Corey Campbell, number 26. Spring, Texas, started the season as a starter. Now listed as a third-teamer. Biggest play of his career.
Ball just got away from Pennington. Threw it high, tried to throw the in route to Keith Brown. It sailed on him. And Campbell playing the deep safety, got the pick.
First and 10, 45 seconds to go. Time called. Alabama, they've got one left. Well, I can only imagine, Todd, Brody Croyle, Ray Hudson sitting back in Tuscaloosa watching this, hearts aching right now. Opposite emotions on the orange side. 17-13, Tennessee with 40 seconds remaining, Alabama with one timeout left.
You know, I want to say something, and I don't mean this in any disrespectful way to Spencer Pennington, because I think he had a valiant effort out there today. I think he's getting better each week he plays, but he's just not at the same level as a quarterback that Brody Croyle was before he got hurt. And I really think, regardless of the Hudson injury, if Brody Croyle would not have gotten hurt, I think Alabama would be 7-0 coming into this game and have been a top 10 team. Now, I don't know if they would have won today here in Knoxville, but Brody was having that kind of a season.
Eric Ainge, there is a flag on the last play. Croyle watching back home.
This is his best game.
Yes,
I mean, I think he grew up some today. Absolutely. 14 of 28. But, you know, every experience is a new one for him right now.
Last penalty against Alabama. So the Volunteers are going to take it out to 6-1. I'm thinking of Mark Richt earlier this week. As his team gets ready for Arkansas, he said, I can't believe I'm saying this, but Roll Tide. Mm. Well, the Georgia Bulldogs getting ready to play the Razorbacks up in Fayetteville, and they were hoping for an Alabama upset because they need someone to knock off this Tennessee team. There's the final timeout used. Phillip Fulmer's team is going to go to 6-1. Let's take a look at the play of the game presented by Wrangler 5-Star Premium Denim and the call from Bob Kessling of the Tennessee Volunteer Radio Network.
Quarter, Alabama leads 10-7. There's the snap. Kick on the way. Low spiral. Tinsley catches it at his 25-yard line. Breaks the first tackle. He's in the middle. He's got running room. Tinsley makes a move on the punter. Makes another cutback. He's got some blockers. Tinsley to the 30, and Tinsley is taken out at the 28-yard line.
45-yard punt return by Derek Tinsley. It set up a touchdown toss from Eric Ainge to Jason Swain that broke a touchdown.
And, I mean, it was the key play of the game, because if you'd have told Mike Shula and Joe Kynes, the defensive coordinator coming in, that you would have come into Knoxville and hold Tennessee's offense to under 200 yards of total offense, you'd think, we're going to win the game. But they didn't. And that play, that punt return that gave Tennessee the short field leading to the Eric Ainge touchdown pass was the difference in this ballgame.
Final play of the game coming up. Phillip Fulmer got doused by Kevin Burnett. I think, you know, he said it's just an ordinary week. Yes, it's the Alabama game. But he has been, that's his daughter Allison, giving him a little peck on the cheek. It can't help but have affected Phillip Fulmer to be the topic of so much print and broadcast journalism in Alabama. Phillip Fulmer, back in July, decided not to attend media days in Birmingham upon the advice of his attorney. He was concerned that he was going to be served with a subpoena in one of the many lawsuits that have been filed in the aftermath of this probation for Alabama. It was a $10,000 fine left on the university by the SEC. And you see that? Wow. Yeah. 17-13, Tennessee wins it. They go to 6-1, and they maintain control of their own fate. They have to go to South Carolina next week, and then they come back to take on Notre Dame team here. Our player of the game defensively, Kevin Burnett, boo. 11 tackles, 3 quarterback pressures. And let's go down to Tracy Wolfson, who is with Phillip Fulmer and Kevin Burnett.
Thanks, Vern. Coach Fulmer, he got you real bad there, didn't he?
I really did. I tell you, he got me great. Yeah, I am so proud of our defensive football team. Just played lights out. And to come here and get this win tonight with all this team has been through, it's just they're an unbelievable bunch of young men.
Not only an SEC win, but a win over Alabama, your rivals. What does that mean to you guys?
Well, it's huge for us. All that we've been through in the offseason, and now, you know, we got the house in the car for another week, so we just got to play balls out for the next couple of weeks.
With the offense struggling, did you guys know you had to do something to step up and win this game?
Yes, ma'am. We knew our offense was struggling from time to time. We got a young quarterback, so we like the pressure on our shoulders as a defense.
You told us this team is so much fun to coach. How proud of you are you of them?
I am really proud of them. You don't know how well everybody says, that's watched us has seen how far that we've come as a football team, and it's really special to go to work with them every day and watch them improve, you know, and they've got such great heart and character. And I tell you, the Alabama team did too. It was a heck of a Tennessee-Alabama football game.
What's with all these winning these close games, winning ugly? What's going on?
We're the heart attack kids, I guess. But if that's the way it's going to be and you get a win, you're happy with it, you know.
Thank you, both of you. Congratulations. You. Back to you, Vern.
All right, Tracy, thank you. And our congratulations to the Tennessee Volunteers. It was a hard-fought win.
Yeah, and to me, that's what Alabama-Tennessee is. It's what SEC football is. And I for one, hope that this legal stuff will they'll get rid of it. It'll go away. I think this game is better than that. This rivalry is better than that. And it's, you know, it doesn't affect the players. It doesn't affect the coaches per se when they're out there for 60 minutes. It's a fan thing. It's a media thing. It's a lawyer thing. And I think it's disgusting, really. I really wish it would just go away.
Now, Tennessee opened up with a fumble return by Paris Harrelson. Gave him a 7-0 lead. An interception set up the Alabama touchdown. 7-7. It was 14-10 at the break. That big play by Derek Tinsley to set up the go-ahead touchdown. And then they went back and forth. Ultimately, Tennessee wins it 17-13 to go 6-1 for the year and 4-1 in SEC play. Tonight on CBS, it's a night of drama and mystery. Don't miss Cold Case, NCIS, and a new edition of 48 Hours Mystery tonight on CBS, America's most watched network. You know, it's a privilege for us to do these games.
Absolutely.
This was memorable. For Tracy Wolfson, Todd Blackledge, I'm Vern Lundquist. We'll see you next week, Georgia and Florida.